In the previous video, we got the general overview about the multivibrator circuit. And we had seen that in case of the astable multivibrator circuit, both states are astable states. And continuously, the output used to get changed between the two states. And we had also seen that this circuit can be used to design the relaxation oscillator. And if you are not aware what is relaxation oscillator, then it is a type of oscillator where the output is non-sinusoidal. So let us see how this astable multivibrator can be designed using the op-amp. Now to realize this astable multivibrator, the op-amp is used with the positive feedback. And when op-amp is used with the positive feedback like this, then this circuit is known as the Schmitt trigger. Now we have already discussed about the Schmitt trigger in detail in the earlier video. So you can check that video to learn more about the Schmitt trigger circuit. But for the sake of completeness, let us briefly understand about this Schmitt trigger circuit. So here, the fraction of output voltage is given as a feedback to this non-inverting terminal. But because of this positive feedback, the output should continuously grow. And as you know, the output cannot grow continuously. And it will get restricted by the supply voltages. So let's say, initially, the output of this Schmitt trigger is equal to positive saturation voltage. And the fraction of this output voltage is given as a feedback to this non-inverting terminal. That is equal to R2 divided by R1 plus R2 times this voltage Vset. Or let's say that is equal to beta Vset, where beta is nothing but the feedback fraction. So now if this input voltage Vin is less than this voltage beta Vset, then the output will remain to this positive saturation voltage. Because the output of the op-amp can be given as the open loop gain times the difference between the two input terminals, that is V plus minus V minus. And as the voltage at the non-inverting terminal is more than the voltage at the inverting terminal, the output will be positive saturation voltage. But now when this input voltage is greater than this voltage beta Vset, at that time, the output will go from the positive saturation voltage to the negative saturation voltage. So when this Vin is greater than the voltage V plus, that is the voltage which is appearing at this node, then the output will go from positive saturation voltage to the negative saturation voltage. And at that time, the voltage which appears at this terminal V plus will be equal to minus Vset times R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Or let's say that is equal to minus beta Vset. So the output will remain the same until the input voltage goes below this voltage. And once that happens, once again, the output will switch from the negative saturation voltage to the positive saturation voltage. So if you see the transfer characteristic of the Schmitt trigger, then it will look like this. So here, this VUT is nothing but the upper threshold voltage, and in this case, it is equal to beta Vset. And this VLT is nothing but lower threshold voltage. So in this case, it is equal to minus beta times Vset. So in this case, whenever the input voltage goes above this upper threshold voltage, then the output will switch from the positive saturation voltage to the negative saturation voltage. And whenever the input goes below this lower threshold voltage, at that time, the output will switch from the negative saturation voltage to the positive saturation voltage. So this is the basic working principle of the Schmitt trigger circuit. Now so far in this Schmitt trigger circuit, we have assumed that the input signal is applied externally. But suppose if we provide the feedback from output to the input side via resistor and the capacitor, then the same circuit can be used as a astable multivibrator. So let us see the working principle of this astable multivibrator. So here we are assuming that the initial voltage across this circuit is equal to positive saturation voltage. So from this path, the capacitor will start charging toward the positive saturation voltage. And here we are assuming that the op-amp is an ideal op-amp. So no current is flowing into the op-amp terminal. So as soon as this capacitor starts charging, the voltage will get built up across this capacitor. And if you see the voltage at this node, the voltage at this node will also get built up. Now whenever this voltage will reach the upper threshold voltage, or in this case let's say that is equal to beta Vset, then the voltage at the inverting node will be slightly more than the voltage at the non-inverting node. So the output of the op-amp will switch from the positive saturation voltage to the negative saturation voltage. And now the capacitor will start charging towards the negative saturation voltage. And as soon as the voltage just go below this minus beta Vset voltage, at that time the voltage at the non-inverting terminal will be slightly more than the voltage at the inverting terminal. So once again the output will switch from the negative saturation voltage to the positive saturation voltage. And in this way, by charging and discharging of this capacitor, we will get the square wave at the output. So here the time period T of this astable multivibrator depends upon the value of this R and C, and as well as it also depends upon the value of this upper and the lower threshold voltage. So eventually we can say that it depends on the value of this R1 and R2. So the time period of this square wave for the given multivibrator circuit can be given by the expression 2 times RC natural log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. So here, as this positive and the negative saturation voltages are equal, so the duty cycle of this square wave will be equal to 50%. But if upper and the lower threshold voltages are different, in that case duty cycle can be more or less than the 50%. But here, for the simplicity, just let us assume that the duty cycle of the square wave is equal to 50%. So for the given configuration, let us design a astable multivibrator which has a frequency f of 1 kHz. So if f is equal to 1 kHz, then the time period t will be equal to 1 millisecond. So let us put this value t in the expression 2 RC times natural log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. And here, for simplification, let us assume that R1 is equal to R2 is equal to R. So if R1 and R2 are equal, in that case the beta will be equal to 1 by 2. So this 1 plus beta will become 3 by 2 and the 1 minus beta will become 1 by 2. And the equation will get simplified to the 2 RC times natural log of 3. So now here, let us assume the value of C as 0.1 microfarad and let us find the value of this R. So R will be equal to T divided by 2 times this value of capacitor multiplied by natural log of 3. So if you put all the values and solve this expression, then the value of R would roughly come as 4.5 kilo ohm. So what we can do over here, we can use a potentiometer of 5 kilo ohm and we can tune that pot to the value of 4.5 kilo ohm. So to get a frequency of 1 kHz, we can select the value of C as 0.1 microfarad and value of R as 4.5 kilo ohm. And we can select value of R1 and R2 as 10 kilo ohm. So in this way, we can design a astable multivibrator which has a frequency of 1 kHz. Now some of you might be wondering how we have got this expression for the astable multivibrator. So let us quickly derive this expression. So for this derivation, we are only considering the steady state condition of the circuit. And here we are initially assuming that the voltage initially across the capacitor is equal to minus beta Vset. And it is charging towards the positive saturation voltage. Now in the earlier videos of the transient analysis, we had seen that the voltage across the capacitor can be given by this expression, that is V final plus V initial minus V final times e to the power of minus t by RC. So in this case, V final is the voltage towards which the capacitor is charging. So in this case, V final will be equal to positive saturation voltage. And initial voltage across the capacitor is equal to minus beta V set. And here we want to find this time T1 which is required by the capacitor to charge from the minus beta V set voltage to the plus beta V set voltage. So we can say that this Vc of T1 will be equal to V set plus minus beta V set minus V set into e to the power of minus T1 by RC. Now at time T1, the voltage across the capacitor will be equal to plus beta V set. So now let us just simplify this expression, and if we simplify it, then we can write it as beta minus 1 is equal to minus 1 plus beta times e to the power of minus T1 by RC. Or we can say that 1 minus beta divided by 1 plus beta, that is equal to e to the power of minus T1 by RC. So let us take the natural log on both sides. And taking the natural log, we can say that T1 is equal to minus RC times natural log of 1 minus beta divided by 1 plus beta. That is equal to RC times natural log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. So this is the time T1 which is required by the capacitor to charge from the minus beta V set voltage to the plus beta V set voltage. Now here, as the duty cycle of the square wave is 50%, so intuitively we can say that the time required by the capacitor to go from this plus beta V set voltage to this minus beta V set voltage should remain the same. That is, T1 should be equal to T2. But still, let us derive the expression for this time T2. So in this case, the initial voltage across the capacitor is equal to beta V set, and the capacitor is charging towards the negative saturation voltage. So we want to find the time T2 which is required by the capacitor to go from this plus beta V set voltage to the minus beta V set voltage. So we can say that Vc of T2 will be equal to minus V set plus beta V set minus of minus V set times e to the power of minus T2 divided by RC. So if you put the value of this Vc of T2 as minus beta V set, then the expression can be written as minus beta times V set, that is equal to minus V set plus V set times 1 plus beta into e to the power of minus T2 divided by RC. So if we simplify this expression, then we can write it as 1 minus beta, that is equal to 1 plus beta times e to the power of minus T2 by RC. Or we can say that 1 minus beta divided by 1 plus beta is equal to e to the power of minus T2 divided by RC. And if we simplify this expression, then T2 will come out as RC times the natural log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. So this expression is same as the expression of T1. So the total time T is the summation of T1 and T2. So time period T will be equal to T1 plus T2, or we can say that is equal to 2 times T1, that is equal to 2 times RC times natural log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. So in this way, we got the expression of the time period for the case of astable multivibrator which is designed using the op-amp. And using this expression, we can design a astable multivibrator for the desired frequency. So I hope in this video you understood how we can design the astable multivibrator using the op-amp. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.